But I will be swift with the verse and then with the Bhaktivedanta purports. The Prabhupada made a mega rendering of this book, of this literature, 16,000 verses of Srimad Bhagavatam. Who can imagine that? Prabhupada's undertaking was such a volume of love and care for humanity. And do you know that Srila Prabhupada got these books translated into 50 languages? Do you realize what that means? To get any book, only the most famous authors in the world, they get translated to many languages. I mean, for me it means humble, because for all the Ouida therapy has only been translated to 3 languages yet. And Gurudev Atulananda's books will not be translated because they're poetry in Spanish, so they can't be translated. So, but Prabhupada got the Srimad Bhagavatam. Translated into more than 50 languages. I personally was participating. I was involved in the BBT Spanish, in the BBT Swedish, then Scandinavian languages, German language. So I knew I was right in the middle of the BBT working. Claro, sería una delicia tener un poquito de agüita para el cuello en la clase. ¿Sabes? Son costumbres de los seres humanos tomar agüita cuando hablan mucho. Entonces, this Bhagavatam work of Srila Prabhupada, you know, that is a bigger work than making all these kind of big temples. Many big temples have been constructed and they're still being constructed, but literature-wise, there's no other work like the Srimad Bhagavatam. There's nothing which compared to that edifice of divine knowledge for to be spread all around. And Prabhupada made it his life mission that Srimad Bhagavatam should reach the world. And it did reach the world. Even there's one volume, versions, I have one, but it's not here, like where all the Bhagavatam is in one volume with all the purports of Prabhupada in amazing thin paper, like the 1,000 page version. Wow! Srila Prabhupada, Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. And not only this, but Prabhupada then organized the distribution of Srimad Bhagavatam by his volunteer devotees all around the world. They went and took those books to libraries and to universities and to the common man and to all the temples. Practically, you can see the set of Srimad Bhagavatam in many places. Why? Because Prabhupada put his love and devotion in there. And Prabhupada's love and devotion is the devotion of a pure devotee. Please turn on the fan. Prabhupada's love and devotion for the world was of such a unique type. Prabhupada's love and devotion was of such a unique character that he actually included Muslims, Christians, Buddhists, atheists, men, women, white, black. Nobody could escape Srila Prabhupada's love and concern for humanity. So this is what we are celebrating here. Now we are in the Adivas. We are coming up to Prabhupada's disappearance festival. So it's just after Kartik. So Srila Prabhupada was the man of humanity. But has any of these dumb people realized that? Of times, the times 100 most important people of the cycle, of the time, no? They always have this trying to glorify certain people who invent the light bulb and things like that. They're getting all the glory there. But the one who put on the light for spiritual enlightenment, they have no idea. And what they did and what Prabhupada did. You see, I am glorifying my guru. Okay, that's fine. Every disciple glorifies his guru. It's the nature of a disciple to glorify the guru. Oh, it's like oil in the motor. You can run again. So Srila Prabhupada, his contribution to humanity has been ignored, largely ignored. Very strange, a very strange phenomenon. Because we can understand it, because Prabhupada is defeating the Mayavadis, the illusionists, those who say that God does not exist. He defeats them down to the root, so they don't want to give any credit to him. That's basically the reason. And materialism doesn't want to give much of a credit to Srila Prabhupada either, because Prabhupada called all materialists bloody idiots. So that's hard for the materialist to say Bhaktivedanta Swami is the greatest. Because he calls us what we are. So we are following a very secret star of humanity. Prabhupada is a not recognized star. No Nobel Prize. Prabhupada didn't even get one doctora honoris causa. You know any of those dumb politicians who little famous for little thing that anywhere they go, universities invite them and give them doctora honoris causa. Means by honor of your work, we will give you a doctorate. Prabhupada didn't get one single one. Even though he did such an amazing work for humanity, but he remained basically occult. Prabhupada, Prabhupada always put this movement in the name of Krishna. Prabhupada didn't make the Bhaktivedanta Swami movement. All the other yogis around the world, they always make the yogis movement. The yogis movement A and B and C. There's no name of Krishna mentioned. Look at that, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. Ramdev Baba, Isha, Jati. This is all, my name is the Supreme. So I give my most humble obeisance to my spiritual master, and I want you to understand that my glorification of his work is not the disciple's glorification, it is the impartial observation of a spiritual and intellectual giant which humanity has seen, which nobody can really parallel him. He has had many God brothers. None of them have published any books. Here and there, a little bit, you know? No. They have not published books. And Prabhupada was not trained a scholar, he was a chemist. But simultaneously, he was so scholarly that he could invade the world of scholars. Today I wanted to present you to you the thesis called Pilgrimage Tourism, a Case Study of Rajmanda. This was our India secretary of the Vishwa Vaishnava Rajshama, Rasa Bihari. He was with us. He came here when we were having the Vishwa Vaishnava Rajshama meeting with Von Maharaj. He was the secretary. He wrote this. This is his PhD. He made a PhD in administration from Kurukshetra University for the degree of doctor in philosophy in tourism. So in this book, he has given so much evidence to the importance of parikrama and how parikrama is manifesting in so many places. India is a place of parikrama. Everywhere you go is a holy place. It's amazing. The 12 Jyotirlingas, the 51 Shakti Pithas around India. And then the main places like Tirupati, Srinathaji Nathwar, Pandharpur in Maharashtra. Then we go on. Vaishnavi Devi, that's a great Vaishnava. That's a cave in Kashmir. Then go to Gaya, to Bihar, where you also go to Vishnupad temple. And of course, the Buddha achieved enlightenment there. Prayag, Allahabad, Kumbh Mela, Kashi, Varanasi, famous city of Lord Shiva. Pushkar, famous holy place of Lord Brahma. Kurukshetra, famous holy place of Lord Krishna. Nasik, famous holy place of Kumbh Mela. Amarnath, famous holy place of Lord Shiva. Rishikesh, famous yoga city. Chitrakoot, famous holy place of Ramlila. Naimishananya, famous holy place of Fushima Bharata. Ganga Sagar, the famous holy place where the Ganga enters into the ocean. Jamunotri, famous holy place where Yamuna is born. Gangotri, famous holy place where Ganga is born. Kiranaji. Kedarnath, famous high temple in the Himalaya. Omkareshwar, Mount Kailash, Kanjakumari, this means the highest place in the Himalayas and the the place southmost tip of India, Sri Rangam. This is electrified system that needs to get some earth.
Ground, yeah.
It's not grounded. It's crazy. So I get a real shock here. Madurai is a famous place of Durga. Guruvayur, famous holy place of Lord Krishna. Sri Rangam, the famous holy place of Ramanuja Sampradaya. Udupi, famous holy place of Madhvacharya Sampradaya. Bhuvaneshwara, holiest places of temples in Orissa. Of course, then there is the Sikh place, Amritsar. It's also very, it just goes on, you know. In India, every place is a holy place. They have so many shrines. We have not even mentioned Mahaprabhu's shrines. We have not mentioned the places where the associates of Mahaprabhu come from, or Tukaram or Kabir or no, India is, everything is holy here, you know. You get like it blows your mind, you know. Everywhere they say glories, glories, glories to the holy place, no? And by doing so and by doing parikrama to those holy places, there's an incredible movement. That's what this PhD thesis is pointing out. This is an industry. The parikrama world of the saints, that is a great industry. It promotes transporting, it promotes local prasadam, hotels, supposed to be dharmshalas, not hotels, where humble people do their preaching. Very amazing. The scriptures and the holy places, these are really historical things. And slowly, slowly, we are creating in South America sanctuaries like that, so that you can go to Diaguitas. Diaguitas is a holy place in Chile. It was, when I first about heard about the Valle de Elqui, I was making fun of it a little bit, you know, and the holy place. And then there was one lady, she cheated everybody in Valle de Elqui. She told that UFOs are going to pick her and her followers up, and she had all her followers sell all their buildings in Santiago and bring the money, and then no UFO came, but who ran away with all the money was that lady. So that was one famous story of Valle de Elqui. But at that time we didn't have a temple there. But in the Valle de Elqui now there's four temples, four beautiful places, the devotees of Krishna. Now it is the Valle de Elqui is a holy place. And on the Mamajuka, on the holy mountain of the Diaguita natives, there is now Lord Jagannath Mandir. Lord Jagannath, beautiful place. And then you go around in Vicuña, there's another huge place where the devotees are preaching with prasadam. I mean, it's so surprising. Then you go deep down in the valley, we just re-established a place which Muniji had. We are up there in the mountain at 3,800 meters. You find the devotees chanting Hare Krishna and doing incredible things. Who can understand this plan of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? This is a plan of creating sanctuaries so that the people can visit and get purified. So in this way, like Lord Krishna and the sadhus established these places in India thousands of years ago, we are establishing them now. That when Guru Deva goes to Punta Arenas, then he makes a new holy place in Punta Arenas. Already we are in Ushuaia, in the southern tip of Argentina. And we are in Misiones, next to the Cataratas Iguazu. There's the devotees are there. So this thing, but that has to be done without egotism. You cannot establish a holy place like a private business. That is not a private business. This is something it has to be for the sake of the benefit of the people. Oh, of course, some people may be living there, some people may be working there, some people may get some benefit out of such a holy place, but that the purpose is not for that. Why are we now wanting to make Suryakunda the model village for Braj? To bring the Braj consciousness and the people who come to Braj to a top level of appreciating holy grounds. People forgot what is a holy ground. They forgot what is a holy place. Not in India, but in Braj Mandal, it was forgotten the importance. Even the local villagers, they are very surprised. Why are these people coming from Chile and Germany and paying interest in our silly little village, you know? Why? Well, because Radharani meets Krishna there every time at noon. That's why, little stupid, you think we are going there just because there's a little lake? There's lakes everywhere in the world. Come to see the Titicaca Lake in Peru and Bolivia. It's the biggest lake in the world, and it is a holy lake. It is the holy lake of the Inca. So we're not coming to Suryakunda for a little water. We're coming there for Radha and Krishna and for bringing a spiritual upliftment into India. And Siddha Baba Madhusudana's Babaji Maharaj, he also came for that purpose. Even that, if you look at the crown, the mukut of the crown in the stone, this is just by great fantasy that you can see a mukut in there. But Siddha Baba saw it and he said, this is Radharani's crown in Haribol. And now everybody is believing it and celebrating it, and Suryakunda is getting famous for it. So this is the place of Siddha Baba in Haribol. And the Babaji's in competition of the Gaudiyas, they also do that. The Babaji's, they make a lot of work to make some of the holy places famous in India. They have done actually quite a good job. In Lika Chakra, they have made a huge temple for Lord Nityananda's birthplace, like that. So in Haridas Thakur's place, there's a celebration. We find some Babaji's, they have taken care of his Samadhi Mandir and things like that, no? So it's not only Gaudiya Vaishnavas. It's the work of creating sanctuaries is really of many. Like if I go to Udupi, of course I'm going to visit the Madhvacharya Sampradaya's main temple of Krishna. If you look the way they worship Krishna there, oh my God, oh my God, everything we do in puja, everything we do in puja all around the Vaishnava world is altogether a little pipsqueaking against what they do in Udupi. Every dress the Lord uses there has an estimated value of $5 million. Those dresses of those deities, they are just ornate jewelry working with the precious stones. No wonder the British people wanted to steal from the temple. They couldn't believe it. There's more jewelry on this deity than the Queen of England had after stealing 20 years around the world, you know, 200 years, sorry, you know. I mean, already this little Krishna deity there, he has more jewels, and he has so many outfits, so many dresses. So can you imagine what the Udupi Krishna Swamis